And welcome to this panel discussion on the new normal, especially in the event space. I'd like to take this opportunity to give a short description on the companies and organizations that these four gentlemen represent. They are perhaps the best event companies in the state of Kerala and having a national and global outreach. I'll start with Harish Babu and Hari from Impresario. These two gentlemen head a prestigious organization called Impresario Events. It's a pioneering event management company from Kerala who started the journey in the late 1990s and went global thereafter. Among some of the most popular events and properties that they own is the coveted Miss Kerala pageant that happens every year and every woman in Kerala looks forward to. Joel from Rainmaker Events likes to be known as the event wizard, as he would like to be called. Heads up the company called Rainmaker Events, an event company renowned for organizing exotic and extravagant weddings across the globe. For Joel and his team, weddings are a matter of absolute passion. Raju Kannampura from Executive Events heads up this beautiful organization, which started out in the event management space when most of us would not have even heard of the word events. He rapidly scaled up and became synonymous with very large format conferences and exhibitions, especially doctor conferences. The first big event he fondly remembers is the 54th annual conference of the Cardiological Society of India in 2002, incidentally held at the Le Méridien Kochi. And as they say, the rest is history. So once again, welcome to all the four of you, and thank you for taking the time to come on this panel for a discussion on the future of how we see normalcy coming up in event space. I'd like to start with Harish Babu and Hari, and you can choose who would like to take the question from me. What would be differently done by event management companies, in your opinion, post-COVID? How do you see it changing and morphing?
See, the current situation, when it started itself, we even started thinking what is going to be our future. So initially we thought, okay, let's take 1 month and then decide what to be done. And then 1 month is over. Right now also, we cannot decide on what is going to happen, whether this is going to continue or we'll have to live with it, or when is the medicine is going to come in. So whatever decision if we take today is also not valid in the next month. So we are expecting this should contain in another couple of months and live with it. So we'll have to make the precaution, the events based on the precautions laid by the governments. So that is what we see.
Right. I think the landscape is rapidly evolving, and there's no real way of predicting what's going to happen in the next few days. When you started off, you started with lockdown one, then it was lockdown two, then it was lockdown three and four. We don't know if there's going to be lockdown five. So I understand and appreciate where you're coming from. Raju, what are your views on this?
See, I think we have to start thinking of living with COVID or with this kind of restrictions. I am not at all seeing about this COVID. When we are putting, we have to think of a new culture and new style of doing events. And definitely that will be based on the protocol. We can call it as protocol-based events will be the future of event management. So people will be fully conscious about the hygienic aspect of movements. So the people movement will be a hygiene-driven movements and lifestyle, and even the body language will also be changed according to the protocol or the hygiene aspect. So people's subconscious mind itself will be encrypted with some sort of hygiene consciousness. That is my observation.
Right. That's my right. Thank you, Raju. Joel, what are your views on this? On how you see the post-COVID era unfolding for event companies and the entire event space as such?
So COVID has hit us all very hard. It's a reality that we've got to start dealing with. For a lot of people, till the vaccination comes out, COVID is something that we'll have to start living with, is what we believe. So it's not something that's going to go away in the next 3 months or 6 months or a year. So event managers and wedding planners have to slowly start preparing themselves to create events, weddings, social events, MICE, whatever, with having COVID amongst us. This is not to make it very depressing and a negative thought. It could be there. So Malayalis especially are used to very large numbers of people attending social events in the 500s, 1000s, 2000s, 5000s. That is one behavior that cannot work with these protocols and all in place. So one behavioral paradigm shift that is going to happen is where people will slowly start embracing the 50 number weddings or the 100 number weddings or the 200 number social celebrations, which is already used by people in North India for their destination events, or people abroad where select number of very intimate close people go for all of these events and they have a series of events. So that is one shift that I definitely think will happen over the next 6 months, and a cultural change that will happen, especially in the minds of Malayalis. Number two, another thing is, even when these 100, 200 or whatever events will start increasing in terms of the number of people will start increasing, the vulnerable sections of the societies, like the elderly or the kids below 12-year-olds, they still cannot be exposed to such events. So it is actually a little depressing and stigmatic where they may not be able to come to the forefront of all of these celebrations. There will have to be virtual measures or other measures which will have to be given to them so that they can also be part of the celebrations. And in many countries, you already see a lot of drive-in concerts happening, a lot of ticketed digital events happening. You see a lot of virtual weddings happening. So COVID has also brought forth a lot of potential opportunities for a lot of people to stop doing what they were already doing and embark on a whole new journey. So as time moves by, as we get more closer with COVID-19 being a part of life, I'm pretty sure and certain that a lot of new other events and things will come into play. Like Raju sir talked about robotics and AI. There are so many more things that are going to explode into our event space. We just have to be very welcoming about welcoming and quick and proactive to bringing them very quickly.
Sure. Thank you, Joel. The next question I would like to pose to Raju. The general opinion seems to indicate a demand increase for outdoor events, you know, in this COVID environment. What is your opinion on this new interest that people seem to have? You know, we've seen customers demonstrating a desire to opt for outdoor events, non-AC venues, which are still luxurious and still upmarket, yet not necessarily indoor venues. What is your view on that?
I think that is a temporary thought process. Maybe it's a temporary mechanism. Maybe the fear consciousness of people, things like that. Definitely, it will go off. Mainly the fear of air-conditioned environment can contaminate the diseases or transfer the virus or something like that. Maybe that is the thought process. But as far as in Malayali's mind, Kerala mindset, it is like that. Definitely, people will forget about that fear. and they will come back. Mainly the local crowd, that Malayali crowd, they prefer to be in air conditioned environment. Sure. They want to do it in air conditioned environment because of a few reasons. Like one is the climatic situation of Kerala, the most humid, maybe that is the reason. Second thing is the air conditioned hall or air conditioned environment thinks that it's a part of Kerala's hypocrisy, or maybe that is a style, or that is the luxury, or something like that. I think maybe like
it's viewed as being upmarket, you mean to say.
Yeah. Right. So mainly the wedding market, especially the social events and the Kerala events. But definitely people who are coming from outside, from North India or other part of the country or other part of the world, they prefer outdoors because they want to be with the nature, or sure, they are more nature loving. So definitely outdoors will be beneficial. But both indoors and outdoors, the properties with both indoors and outdoors will get more upper hand while approaching the market, because they have more things to choose in between. So I think outdoors will get more benefit for some time. Then definitely they will switch over to the air conditioned environment after the settlement of all the pandemic situations. I think my observation is like that.
Sure. Joel, you would like to add to that?
Yeah, so just adding to what Raju sir said, so no matter how atmospheric and beautiful our natural environments are, we also have a big issue of rainfall, heavy rains and storms at least 5 to 6 months throughout the year. So even in a post-COVID scenario, not just the immediate next 2 or 3 months, you really cannot practically have a lot of destination weddings or things in an outdoor environment unless you're again physically tenting it up and doing the other infrastructure support. So it is not going to exclusively be an outdoor per se. People are going to get into a mix of both outdoor and indoor, and that fear of consciousness of ballrooms will have to change sooner or later.
Right. Or maybe some technology will come to the aid of making sure air condition is not a way of spreading the disease, right? Perhaps.
Absolutely.
I guess right now the apprehension is that if you're in an indoor environment with air condition, be it an aircraft, be it an airport, be it a hotel, be it an event venue, the disease and the droplets could be contaminating others. I guess once that fear is taken care with some kind of a solution that comes up in terms of something that the sanitizing industry provides us, I think the entire fear may just completely vanish there.
Absolutely.
I hear what you're saying. Thank you. So you're saying, both of you are saying, and I'm I understand that the key point here is that it's going to continue to be an outdoor and indoor play. It won't be just an outdoor play or an indoor play. It'll be a combination of both. And I guess in the times to come, we'll know what wins eventually.
Yeah.
My next question goes to Harish, or maybe Hari can take the question. I'll leave that to you. What do you think is the future of large events, like, live shows, performances, medium-sized events? Like, for example, the Miss Kerala event is something that you've been doing year after year. It's an extremely successful property that you've developed, and people look forward to it. It's every Keralite's dream, every Keralite woman's dream to be part of the Miss Kerala pageant. How do you see this whole thing panning out? Is it going to destabilize the whole foundations of these kind of large events? Or you think we will evolve into something else and maintain the momentum that we have for events? For example, you've done live shows up in Calicut as well as in Kochi in the past. So how do you see this panning out?
For some time, I think the current situation, it is going to, we'll have to wait to see some such kind of larger events. But you can't take out the feeling of a large event from anybody. The sense of the five senses satisfaction which you get from a larger event, the live event, which cannot be taken out by the any digital event or anything which is happening these days. But since the epidemic is there and the COVID is going to be there with us, so we will have to wait for 6 to 8 months. We'll have to wait to see the such kind of larger events. The events like Miss Kerala, yes, we have to take a decision what format we should be going in. But we are waiting. We are waiting. I mean, we would love to do, see the larger events coming back, and people are being happy about attending the larger events.
I'd like to thank you for that, Hari. I'd like to ask the next question to Joel. For weddings, since that's something that you specialize in, Joel, do you think there's going to be a significant change in the way people look at decor and the way wedding is done? The entrance for where the guests come in from, where they sit, where they dine, where the photo opportunities are during the event. Do you see a significant change in all of that?
It's going to be a huge change. In fact, all of the event community, all of the event management agencies and wedding planning companies within EMAC are also planning and coming up with protocols and structures that people can use and follow in their weddings. So one, weddings will have invitee list verification assistance. So let's say if you're having 50 people or 100 people attending the event, it will come upon the event manager or wedding planner's responsibility to ensure that these people are coming from COVID safe zones, they're not coming from containment zones. Also, RSVPs are a big part of other smaller weddings, but it's not a big deal with Malayalis at all. RSVPs are going to play a huge role going forward in any social event or wedding where you send a digital invite to somebody, they will have to RSVP their confirmation or declination and mention that they are going to come with a plus one or a plus two. Because unless you confirm or decline, I really can't go back as a host or as an event manager to somebody else and ask, can we bring two other people? So that is going to change. Then apart from the verification, everybody's already thinking about thermal screening stations, infrared stations, sanitizer stations, giving masks and gloves to people. So that is all going to happen. But besides that, I think table service will be maybe 2 people on a 4-foot table or 3 people on a 6-foot table. Catering solutions are going to move from large buffet counters to maybe prepackaged plated boxes with maybe a 5 or a 6 set fantastic menu with entrees, appetizers, main courses and desserts. So it's easy to take and dispose. Sure. And you can also look at butler services where you have one COVID safe butler for a table giving or serving 5 to 6 different items on a particular table. Photographs and things are very important. You can't take that away from any guest that's going to come. So they're going to go near these backdrops or installations and click lots and lots of lovely pictures. But the money that used to go on a central backdrop or on a single large installation will be divided into Instagram-worthy environments of multiple installations or artworks, which are, again, contactless, where four people or five people are the max that can come and stand near it and click a photograph near that environment. Similarly, sure. In terms of entertainments or engagements, you're going to have live bands like EMAC did a conference with the Honorable Tourism Minister yesterday. You will have 10, 12 people of a live band performing at the studio, which will be live telecasted at the wedding venue. You will have interactive engagements perform live where they will be 2 or 3 people at the max. A lot of their equipment and machinery will also have to be sanitized. Then going forward, you will not have handshakes, greetings and hugs or kisses. People are going to refrain from all of that. Fashion is going to be different because you're not going to go to a fashion store and try out a kurta or a suit or whatever because you're already afraid about who's been there before and what it could pertain to. So fashion stores will have to come out with virtual outlets for weddings or social events, and it'll be customizable solutions which can go to these people's homes and give them their solutions then and there for a certain price differential or a premium. So I think it's going to hit every single department of a wedding in different ways.
So I guess, you know, invitations won't be physical invitations anymore, right from that stage, you know. All the way to the takeaway gift could just be a photograph that just comes to you on your WhatsApp, perhaps.
Takeaway gifts can be physical. I think I personally think that takeaway gifts is a big segment that is going to explode because you only have 50 people. Earlier, you used to have 500 or 1,000 people come to a wedding. You really can't put in so much attention to detail in curating or coming up with something innovative to give your guest. So to everybody who's going to watch this video, takeaway gifts is a big market that is going to explode as long as you can provide safety precautions and you can come up with exceptional stuff. People are not going to stop spending money on celebrations or not gifting people or anything. You just need to attack the segments in the right way.
Sure. You know, incidentally, I was talking to a few of the industry colleagues and we got a wedding inquiry only yesterday in which the wedding organizer, that is the father of the bride, wanted to organize a wedding for 200 people. And right now the stipulation is that you can't have more than 50 people at one go. So he had decided to have the wedding start at 11 in the morning, 11 to 11:30, one group comes, another group comes at 12 to 12:30, next one from 1 to 1:30, and the next one from 2 to 4. Yeah, staggered, right? To cover 200. And then you know, incidentally, I told him, why are you doing this? He said, no, that's because I can't do more than 50 at a time. And I told him that, you know, at Meridian, we've got 14 venues, and you can have 50 people in each venue. And he was super excited. He said, you know, that means I can get to my magic number of 1,000 people. I said, yes, you can. So I guess it's innovation is the key, and it's constantly evolving. And if suddenly the government says from 50, it can go up to 100, then that will also change the dynamics.
No, again, the mindset of the people is going to change. No? Like instead of 1,000 invitees or 1,500 invitees, no, he would like to invite only, say, 100 or 150 or 200 people for an exclusive wedding. So in that sense, destination weddings will be a major hit in coming days. No? Like we can promote Meridian as a destination wedding.
Even the smaller groups, when local people also will start looking at the next smaller destinations. You know, where Cochin people will go to
local destinations.
Alappi with the small wedding. Right. So all this small destination will start coming in. That's what
intrastate destination weddings.
I have a different opinion.
Yes, Raju, please.
I have a different opinion that, see, I think people will forget everything, all the restrictions, everything. My perception is like this. If government permits, you can do a wedding event with n number of people you want. Definitely the very next day, there will be 1,500 people. Event will happen.
I mean, people will think, why should I spend unnecessary on these kind of events? So let me say for the future, for my generation.
I have six clients, they are ready to do 500 above wedding event. They are ready. If the government permits, go ahead like that. They are ready for that. So Malayalis will take n number of loans, or they will sell the property and they will do big weddings.
You can't take large weddings out of the mind of a Malayali.
Yeah, correct. It's not a mindset. It is a status quo, social status quo. It's a symbol of social status. So for Malayalis, wedding is a social status quo. So people cannot avoid all these kind of things. Definitely, it will have a setback for at least, as Harish said, 6 months will be a transition period or a sleeping period. Then after that, the people will wake up and they will celebrate. So don't worry about that.
I think there's already pent-up demand. Like I was mentioning, you know, I've already got 3 inquiries since yesterday. So the lockdown closed, opened up only day before yesterday. And we already have 3 inquiries for weddings. So people are just eager to have social events and get together.
I have a few examples like that. See, they have done the wedding ceremony already. People have done. That means the taligat is done, or the small event is already happened. And they are waiting. They are waiting to do a big reception. Immediately after the restrictions is over, they will do a big reception. I think some of the couples will attend with their kids also, maybe for the wedding.
Yes, indeed. I guess the only restriction to hold big events would be government protocols
and interventions.
They are just waiting for the lockdown restrictions to be lifted. Definitely, events will come. We can hope, very optimistic.
Sure.
But on a closing note to that point as well, sir, you can also see destination weddings and boutique weddings slowly growing as a behavior in the Malayali communities also. It's already part and parcel of the other states' mindsets. We will also start going there or traveling that path.
I guess the point is, you know, the big wedding is in the DNA of every Indian. Be it from Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore. I think it's the big fat Indian wedding, clearly describes and aptly describes what our mentality is. We like big weddings, we love them, we can't live without them.
Yeah, definitely.
Every other business is affected, no? Not only event business. So the money crunch is already there in the market. No, even SMSEs, small scale industries, they are now finding it very difficult to survive. So where is the money going to come? So that is, yeah, for
there may be a little chopping of the extravagances, but the number of attendees is a big concern about the wedding ceremonies. So attendees count will be there. But people, they may be prefer to have, instead of 4 non-veg, they will compromise to 3 non-veg. And instead of spending 10 lakhs for a flower decor, they may be compromised to 5 lakhs. But the number of attendees which is a big concern about the people.
Hari or Harish, my next question is, how do you see technology playing a role in this new environment? So we have this new post-COVID environment. You know, for instance, we are doing this virtual call. We're not sitting face to face on a stage with 3 or 4 sofas and, you know, and with a water to and a juice to sip on. We're not doing that, unfortunately. We're doing this over a technology call. So where do you think technology is going to come in? Yes, Harish.
Only thing what we are missing is the coffee from Meridian. You know, technology is already there. I mean, so that is why we are sitting there. So technology is going to impact in lot of sectors, which is ease of business, ease of meetings. So all these areas, like Raju said, the augmented reality and holograms, the RSVP, man management, everywhere the technology is going to come. So that's already there, I think. I mean, we just have to incorporate that into the events and then merge it and do it. But,
you know, for instance, there are restaurants, platforms, tech platforms available now, in which you, from the time that you make a reservation from home till the time you choose what you eat on the menu, till the payment, it's same, everything is digitally managed, you know. So that's also being discussed, and many service providers are entering that area. So similarly, in the event space, what do you think is going to be the technological intervention or support that will come in? Specifically, do you see anything that is coming in the event space?
Yeah, basically, as you said, even for conferences, the number of people attending in a particular venue will be less for another, say, 6 to 1 year. So definitely they will go for web streaming. They will have different sessions as if in a conference, but each single separate sessions will be telecast or webcasted like that. So it will, conferences will happen, but the size of people, the number of people attending the real-time venue will be very less.
Even on the attendees, now we will have to have the face detection technologies with the thermal scanning, and all those things will going to come in the sure. thing.
Sure. Do you think technology will reduce the role of event managers and hotels and venues? Will it reduce the significance of the whole events infrastructure required? You know, so there are two ways of looking at it. Technology can come and support us and make it easier for us to hold events and for the customers and guests to have better events. Or do you think it's going to take away or eat into some of the existing business that hotels and event managers and venues get?
But again, my point is, like, earlier when we do an event, it was 25% the technology and 75% was the actual event kind of set. Now it is changing that the audience is larger. So the 75% is people are going to attend through a digital medium, and the 25% is going to be there in the event. So it's again depending on different kind of events, the nature of the events. If you see, if it's a conference and it doesn't need a physical meeting like this, technology can support. But if it's a wedding where the personal connection is required, you have to meet in person. Where the technology doesn't come in place. So it is based on different objective of the event.
See, I have a different opinion. I have to add on something more to that. See, when we do in an event in India or any part of India or even in Kerala, see, there will be a lot of manpower is involved in that event setup and even contact and the process. But when we do
the production part, you mean to say?
Yeah, the human resource part. But when we do some events outside India, Even I did some event in US. So I have seen only one technician is coming out, and he's having a lot of equipments and a lot of accessories to handle and to support the entire system, setting up operations, everything. So my perception is like that. Maybe in India, the labor is cheap here. Maybe that's why people are add-on people for the setup. But in the near future, there will be a lot of equipments will be imported from other part of the country, other part of the world to India or Kerala. And these equipments will have a lot of facilities for pre-programming and to a lot of functionalities that the human intervention part is very less in operating all these kind of technologies.
Sure.
So that kind of technological equipments will come to Kerala. And there will be only few people are sitting at the backstage, only limited number of people are sitting at the console and doing the setup, everything. So human factor will come down, and there will be technologically advanced equipments will replace the more number of people. And I think that is better for the hygienic part of the contact of event also. I think that is also good to reduce the man movement or a human movement in event management as well as setup. People with intelligentsia will replace the common workers or so-called laborers. There will be people with a good intellect will come to the event management technological handling sections, and they will run the show in a big way. That is my observation.
So you're saying technology will come to our aid and it will positively impact the whole delivery?
Yeah,
especially in these times.
Definitely.
It is not going to supplement what we do currently, but it will complement it positively. However, it will only elevate the whole experience, is what it means.
Yeah.
So there could be a potential expense that comes along with that. There could be an initial expense.
Initial investment will be high. But that will be compensated for the expenses which we are unnecessarily spending for extra labors.
Right.
So we can save that kind of money from there. So there will be less number of labors and technicians, and there will be that will be supplemented with managers and high-end engineers with high intellect.
So better quality manpower and workforce. So it's not numbers, but it's more quality. It's not quantity, it's quality. And
there are a lot of good people are coming from abroad. Mainly, a lot of movements will be there from other part of the country. A lot of Malayalis are working there. They'll be coming back to and settle. They'll start settling in Kerala. So we'll be having n number of surplus Indonesia people, manpower in Kerala. So that also will not be a scarcity in Kerala.
My next question is to Joel. For weddings, what do you think will be the biggest draw for destination weddings? Now that destination weddings moving out of India into international destinations versus Indian weddings moving domestically to various locations, how do you think is this post-COVID situation going to impact that? Is there going to be a shift? For example, people are used to going to Bali for a destination wedding, or to some desert location in the UAE, or to Phuket, or the exotic locations that people seek to make the weddings memorable and make a statement. You think that's going to change and become more domestic in nature, revolving around India, or you think it's not going to change? What's your opinion?
I think that it's going to be more global, as in whichever local destinations can offer global services and project its image as a COVID-safe destination or a COVID-safe venue or a city or a state are going to have huge influxes of weddings and social events. There are already a lot of events that were planned in Italy, France, Spain, Mexico, US, and other places from India itself. So because of these air travel and everything, all of these restrictions coming in, I think it's a huge opportunity for all of these events and weddings to come back into India. Now, when you come back into India, your popular destinations are obviously Rajasthan, Goa, Kerala, and then emerging places like Mahabalipuram, or Shimla and places like that. So when this is again an opportunity for each of these states or destinations to project themselves to the rest of the country that we are COVID safe. We have very few COVID cases. All vendors from the point of embarking or disembarking from an airport till the point that you're entering into a hotel or a resort, staying there, all of the vendors involved, everybody comes under the safety and health protocol guideline. When that kind of communication is put forward to people out there, the destination gets automatically promoted as some place that you can come to and do your celebrations. So we've been promoting, Kerala is one of the best states to do tourism promotion and even MICE promotion. But from a social event angle, I think this is a big opportunity for Kerala also to join the bandwagon and promote for social events and destination weddings, number one. Number two, from a cost differential also, a lot of these people prefer Phuket, Bali, or Dubai and places like that because these places have everything in the ready in terms of catering solutions, in terms of professional vendors, in terms of entertainments and engagements. But when you still come to certain states, you find challenges in terms of how the vendors are dealing, how the state is welcoming with hospitality, challenges at the venue. So even if you look at Kerala, we don't serve alcohol after 11 o'clock, which is a huge deterrent in the minds of any North Indian destination wedding group or couple, because their party starts at 9 or 10 o'clock and they want to go into the wee hours of 3 o'clock and 4 o'clock. So such structural changes or policy changes need to be adapted within the government frameworks, and we need to be very flexible in these times to attract a lot more weddings and social events to come into our state.
So, you know, from the time that we had our first case, you know, India had its first case of COVID in Kerala, and then the numbers spiraled upwards significantly in Kerala, to now being the state which has most beautifully managed the whole COVID crisis. I think Kerala is the poster boy of the whole COVID management process, you know, and our health minister, Shailja Teacher, being hailed by the globe, by the whole world as one of the most efficient administrators that the world has ever seen. And with great support from our CM and the government infrastructure as a whole, the IAS officers, the healthcare workers and all of that, I think Kerala has more than demonstrated its capability of managing such crisis situations. You know, when Nipah happened, it was fantastically managed. When COVID happened, the way it's managed is beautifully done. Do you think this will come as a huge advantage for us in terms of being a preferred destination for weddings to be taking place?
I think Kerala is going to be the poster boy for weddings across the country. One, we are already COVID safe. The communication's out there. BBC is hailing us. The Guardian's hailing us. International news portals and documentary videos are being done around how we prevented COVID from becoming such a big deal in our state, at least. So apart from already giving these communications, and a lot of foreign tourists have gone back safe from our state to other countries. Now what we need to do is use influencers, social media bloggers, use people who are not from the state of Kerala, because that's what we're a little bad at. We don't blow our own trumpet correctly. We need these influencers and bloggers like Amitabh Bachchan, Chiranjeevi, Rajinikanth, Diljit Dosanjh to go out there and say that destination weddings, bring it all back to Kerala. When you get these influencers and huge sports personalities and other media people talking about Kerala as being one of the best COVID-safe destinations in the country, people are already they'll start talking more about us. Sure. Then you put your incentives or measures where you do a two-day or a three-day social event here, the safety measures that we are going to be placing. Then people are aware of what the government is already doing. Then you give some more incentives, maybe in terms of tourism offering and things like that. And most importantly, I believe that now is the time where hotels and resorts can start virtual 360-degree tours, where people don't necessarily need to fly down to experience a venue or a resort or a destination. You can just make a whole 360-degree angle thing and put it out on an app or something, and people can just wear their helmets and go through the entire process from check-in to the room, to the kitchen, to the restaurant, to the bar, to the outdoor venues, to the ballroom, experience it and take a decision then and there. So adding to the earlier technology bit, if we start proactively doing a lot of these things, we'll be able to put us out on the global map out there.
Right.
Not just within the country.
Sure. Thank you, Raju.
I have one statistics to supplement. That's last year, approximately 600 destination weddings in a volume of 10 CR to 100 CR spending has been gone outside the country, outside India. So last year's statistics is like that. 600 destination weddings happen outside different part of the globe from India. I think that 600 weddings or more will be distributed among the Indian states for the next year. So that is the expectation of destination wedding market. So definitely, most of the weddings are from North India to outside the country. So definitely the movement will be to the South India. And this Kerala is the as a safest state.
Ideal.
Yeah, we have to capture that. And definitely there will be a flow from northern part of the country to Kerala, definitely. And one thing we have to be a little cautious about Goa. Goa will be the our best competitor in this aspect, as Goa is having a COVID-free state also is there. But comparing Kerala and Goa, we have different themes and different we have differences to offer. But even Goa is not having that much diverse locations or venues or themes.
Natural
or
environments.
Yeah, is there. And Goa, I think it is all used to be. See, it's more exposed venues. They have more exposed venues. Definitely, Kerala is getting the upper hand. In all other, comparing to all other Indian states, Kerala will be going to get more benefit out of these destination weddings. Definitely.
So I think from what both of you are saying, I think it's safe to summarize that it's very critical for us to be visually present and have top of mind recall with all potential customers. Because if we are a great, if you manage the whole COVID situation very well, and if we keep it as a secret and never show about our capability of doing destination weddings or events of different nature, I think from what I understand from you, we'll be wasting an opportunity. Is that right? Yeah.
Definitely. Use this opportunity wisely.
Right. Can I ask you the next question, Raju? What do you think will be the expectations from venue providers and event venues, you know, hotels, individual standalone venues? What would be the expectation that you think that you as an event company would have from these venues? Or what do you think the customers will have? Because you will voice what the customer wants and you'll be a channel of message and information as what the customer wants. What do you think will be the special things that you would expect from a hotel or a venue?
Yeah, see, hotels, anyway, see, definitely this, the pandemic, the COVID pandemic made a little bit of apprehensions among the customers or the clients or the guests who are approaching the hotel after this. So there will be a little bit of mindset difference from your earlier guest and the guests going to visit in the future. So the hotel should be, I think there should be a little bit of facelift is needed for the hotels or the venues. Little bit of makeover is needed because the people should feel that. The people should see to feel the confidence that they are approaching in a new venue or a new refurbished place, or even in a hall which they have used for their earlier events also. So the, at least the carpet is changed. So there is a new fragrance is there. So people should feel a novel. They should feel a confidence in their mind that because they are feeling that there is a feeling that is there needed. And definitely the hotel should have a strong hygienic protocol. Of all the hotels, they should set it with a protocol should be there with a proper color coding and the WHO standards or a lot of standards. And it has to be displayed when in the venue itself that see this property is having a very strong hygienic protocol based on WHO or these other things. and these are the guidelines. Everything has to be there. And I think you have to incorporate this kind of hygienic protocol in your contract as an annexure in the contract itself, so that the people will have a confidence level. You can boost up the confidence level of the people who are just entering into your property. So that is one thing. And the second thing is your HR. I think you should have a very good training sessions for your staff and the HR. That means the people who are facing the clients. You have to build up the confidence level of the guests who are coming in. So the approach should be a little bit different, and the staff should be a little bit welcoming, and they should give some little bit of tips to increase the confidence level of the guest who want to come into that. So there will be a little bit of you have to have some HR sessions before opening the property for the post-COVID thing. And I think maybe hotel can organize a series of mock events before starting the event, mock events. Because people are well set that their dining out culture is settled, and their events they can organize through these kind of digital platforms and whatever it may be. So at their own premises and their own areas. But people has to be come out and settle in your property. So the footfalls has to be increased. To increase the footfalls, you can organize a series of mock events, a lot of mock events, small events where you can invite some cross-section of different segments of people people will have an experience and they will...
Like a simulation, you mean to say?
Yeah, stimulation, as a part of stimulation. And definitely the cost has to be compromised a little bit, because initially people will be a little bit cost conscious. As Hari explained earlier, people will have people need more liquidity in their hand, so they will be having a little bit of pull in their mind to spend extravagantly. So that is to be there. And you have to develop new marketing tools. You have to chop off all your conservative earlier tools. Like one of the best tools is that the 360 degree walkthrough, which Joel explained, so that people will avoid most of the time the recce trips they will may be avoiding, and people won't be that much interested nowadays to walk around all the places and open all the doors and experience like that. So you have to develop a 360 virtual experience tool, something like that. And the new tools, which are the new style or the new protocol, you can explain in your tools. So that is very important. And what about the space utilization? That is very, very important. Because nowadays the for events, when we want to conduct an event, we need more spaces, because the social distancing will come the first concern. So we will need more spaces, and you have to restrict. That means one particular hall, particular venue, you need a minimum guarantee of 500 pax or 1,000 pax or 200 pax. That you have to little bit relax on that, because people may be, the seating may be widening. So the minimum guarantee of attendees level, you have to...
Needs to be reviewed.
Yeah, you have to compromise a little bit. And the main thing is the hotel also can start developing some sort of IP events or annual events or seasonal events. The hotel can generate their own IP events. And this IP events is mainly to bring out, to highlighting your USPs. Means each hotel will be having their own USPs. And to utilize that USPs, you just develop some annual IP properties so that it can run. I think, sorry, it's not only for a long run, but for a short run, where everything comes to normal, then you can drop off that also. But this is our all small tips where you can attract people. And whenever you select or whenever you incorporate your vendors also, you have to put a strict protocol on vendors, the vendor movements and their screening, the screening of process for vendors and their hygienic protocol activities or movements, everything. So whenever you select the vendors also, you have to be little more careful in that when you do the events also, so that the culture of the hotel can be transferred to the culture to the vendors, as well as jointly it can be transferred to the guest also. So guest experience is very important. So you have to create a different experience altogether. That's my opinion right. on that's my expectations from the hotels. That's my
sure, opinion. Hari, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I will add a couple of points. Whatever points that Raju suggested was very valid. Apart from that, I think you should try to increase your meeting rooms. Like now there will be more demands for say 25 people, 50 people, 100 people, you know, like the numbers will be reduced, no? But the demand will be more for lesser spaces.
Sure.
If you can increase your meeting room spaces, it will be good.
So if you have more venues, like breakout venues, that comes to your advantage.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah, and also like I said earlier, you can start promoting, you know, day events like sort of a picnic kind of a, because your campus is very good and it's very picturesque, so we can have a lot of outdoor activities in the future. So,
right. So all in all, I see there are a lot of solutions and suggestions in terms of managing this post-COVID crisis that the event industry as such is facing. A lot of very innovative and creative ideas and suggestions that have come through. I just have a couple of questions before we bring this session to a conclusion. Raju, this one's for you. With new banquet seating norms, you know, social distancing, 6 feet away from each other, how do you think this change will impact the whole demand supply of event spaces? You know, so for instance, you know, if you have a large venue, for instance, there are several properties in the city of Ernakulam or Kochi who've got lots of large venues. But you know, if you have 50 people capping that the government has come up with, having large venues is of no use. Moreover, even in the smaller venues, you can't utilize all the small venues to the full capacity because there's a norm of 6 feet in all direction that you have to keep away from. So if you have a conference, let's say with a typical capacity of maybe 50 people seating capacity, that may suddenly shrink down to maybe 10 or 15. How do you think this will change the whole supply and demand statistics? Because, you know, there won't be too many venues who can really conform to the requirements that the government has come up with and what people would also expect from a safety point of view. But, you know, the number of events have also potentially reduced. So how do you think the whole thing will balance out?
Yeah, definitely the space requirement will be high. Because in Kerala, the main situation is like that. See, most of the events, I think 90% of the events in Kerala involves the seating. The concept of seating is there. So seating kills the space. See, some of the social events which is happening abroad, they may not be having too many tables or seatings or something. Maybe frequently moving spaces also will be there. So seating kills the space. So definitely bigger spaces will have more advantages, definitely. But the message has to go out to the public, to the market, that we will be providing bigger spaces for lesser guests. So that is the message you have to give to the public. Otherwise, people, see, the mindset of people is like that. See, they may be having a bigger hall, but they won't be allowing a smaller crowd there. So sure. That message you have to go to outside that. So we are having bigger spaces, but we can definitely accommodate a lesser number of crowd with enough spacing and social distancing. Or what kind of distancing, keeping seating distancing. We can call it as seating distancing based on this thing. And we are ready to offer that. So such kind of offers should come from the hotels to the public. Then only people will approach you. And definitely right. The properties with the hotels with a more bigger space can only suggest these things. Otherwise, sure. How can they suggest? If they're having only smaller venues, they cannot suggest that. So if you want to suggest that, still you need a bigger spaces. Definitely, if it, now it is the restriction is 50 numbers, but if it is increased to 100 numbers or 500 numbers also, there will be a restriction that the distancing factor will be there, definitely, at least for 1 year, I think. So there will be a distancing factor, and I think there will be a norms. The government also will be in the future will be putting in norms that such and such a venue should have only such and such capacity. So the capacity of the venues will be decided as a statutory rule or something like that. Some mandate or something will be coming in the future. So definitely people will be coming, I think 10 square feet is needed for a particular person. So multiplied into the square feet. So there is a calculation for that. So government will put a calculation, and definitely the halls will, bigger halls is needed. Definitely, there is a demand.
And there also will be the demand. And also outdoor venue, that will be, there will be a huge demand for outdoor venues like lawns, amphitheater, those kind of venues.
Sure.
I think non-air conditioned outdoor venues also, but there should be a weather protection is needed, because sure. See, 6 months rain is our main issue. Mainly our issue is the rains and weather. So some sort of protection, weather protection, but outdoors are open venues are also recommended.
So thank you Raju and Hari. My last question is open to all the three of you. And the last question really is, you know, the event business is broken down into several sub-segments. Weddings is one of them, which is just local weddings. The other one is destination weddings. Then we have doctor conferences. We have exhibitions. We have corporate groups that come in. And then we have pure conferences. If you look at all these sub-segments that constitute the event space, what, in your opinion, will bounce back, and in what order? What will come first, and how will it bounce back? Will it be weddings first, followed by, you know, the last being exhibitions and everything in between in a certain sequence? What are your views on this? Joel, do you want to have a word first?
So I think local weddings are quickly going to bounce back, because a lot of people have been holding up their social events and weddings for quite some time. So that's the easiest to bounce back for, taking into account the logistic challenges of flight connectivity and other things. So local weddings first, then domestic celebrations like maybe some festivals or things like that, which are all pertaining to health protocols within districts or within cities. And then you move on to domestic destination weddings. Once the international air transfers and things are enabled, then you slowly look at the MICE tourism and other things coming into play. So I would put it in that order with respect to the subsections of dealer meets, sporting events, other kind of corporate events. I think Raju sir and Hari sir will be in a better position to advise about that.
Okay. Hari, would you want to answer that?
Yeah, as Joel said, the number one will be the wedding. Weddings going to stay. Maybe the scale will be down, but it's going to stay, because you cannot indefinitely postpone your wedding. In that sense, we can focus more on destination wedding. With collective efforts of the government and the hoteliers, we can promote Kerala as a destination wedding center. And this, after the wedding, the next probability is signature event, like maybe a invited show or music show, those kind of things. Then the conferences will slowly starting. Conferences will be there, but the numbers will be very less compared to earlier years, but it is going to stay for some more time. So the preference, the first immediate slots will be for weddings, followed by maybe signature events, then followed by the conference, MICE too.
Raji, your views?
Yeah, see, weddings, I think Joel has already told local to domestic to the destination. See, regarding the corporate events, I have expectation that, see, the local corporate houses will open up with events soon, immediately after. See, government has to give a green signal that you can do events like that. So immediately the local corporates, that means the corporate houses, the corporate business houses based in Kerala, they will start functioning. So most of the industries have already started functioning in Kerala. Already started. Maybe a couple of weeks they are in action. So definitely that corporate events will start immediately. So I think your sales team can slowly move out and visit the corporate houses based in Kerala, corporate houses already functioning. So you can take a list of houses which you are in your clients also. You can have a call that your office is functional. Okay, can I have a meeting? You start meeting. I think that you have to start immediately. That is the first segment which is going to open. And regarding the medical conferences, I have seen the medical conferences, in the medical conference scenario, 2020 is a lost year. So it's a blank year. So in the calendar, they have put it as blank. So that means one medical conference, an annual medical conference, which is going to happen in 2020, is just shifted to 2021. The same destination, the same dates, same month, but just pushed to 1 year.
A 12-month shift.
Yeah, 12-month shift. So then the destination will be happening. See, 2021 decided the venue is shifted to 2022. Like that, it is shifted like that. So it will happen in 2021 only. Most of the annual national conferences is going to happen on 2021. 1 year shift. And definitely you have to look into smaller medical events. I think larger properties have already neglected the smaller medical events, which is happening within the state earlier. But you have to focus on that. It will be a precious baby for you. That means Kerala chapters, Kerala medical associations, lot of Kerala association. I think in my count itself, there is 38 local medical associations are there. They are going to start up the meetings by September, October. They will be organizing this. So they will reorganize the schedule from the lost months. So which all conferences is happening, scheduled to happen in May, April or June, they'll be doing it in September, October or November or December like that. So local Kerala chapter medical events are going to be happening and local MICE is going to happen. That means company events are happening. Because there are a lot of products, lot of rebranding, lot of new innovations are working in background in these last 2 months. I know personally that a lot of corporates are working a lot of stuff. And it has to reach to the public. Definitely they need events. So the people are waiting there. I think your sales team can start meeting and approaching the local corporates. So that will be the scene. And for international events, we have to wait at least for 1 month. One single happening can change the entire prediction. That is the invention of the vaccine. So if the vaccine is there, if vaccine is tested and positive and it is true, definitely the globe is open. Totally, the entire window and the door is open.
People will travel.
Everything. So the timelines will break. Totally, the timelines will break, and the wonders will happen. I think by November, December, the vaccine will come. Then the wonders will happen, definitely. Hope the best.
Right. I guess venues and hotels need to continue to do thorough sanitization and ensuring that their premises are absolutely safe. I know for a fact that Meridian follows the SOPs that Marriott has prescribed to us, which is how to sanitize, when to sanitize, what frequency, and so on and so forth. And I think that attention to detail and ensuring that is followed time and again, religiously without altering whatsoever, and having that discipline is going to make the difference between a successful venue and a not so successful venue, I think. But thank you, gentlemen. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to all of you. Your inputs have been extremely valuable, and I'm sure the audience listening to this will be able to gain from it immensely and apply it to their own businesses that are associated with the event space. Thank you so much once again. It's been lovely talking to all of you. And hope we see the vaccination soon. But until then, stay safe.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for the platform.